Harbouring a rich cultural, historic, and political influence over the rest of the world, the geographical region known as the Middle East has never failed to catch the attention of the rest of the world. Post-colonialism, many Arab states seem set on the route to economic prosperity, with some harbouring large oil and gas deposits. However, this hope became short-lived as many countries free of Western influences were crippled by a similar phenomenon, the controversial act of dictatorship.
Gaddafi and his family, they must leave away.
Security Council has failed to uphold its responsibilities to respond to this crisis in the long search for peace and security in the Middle East.
The situation in Syria is a stain on our humanity, on our conscience.
The Arab Spring is turning into a darkening winter.
In this episode of In Depth, we see how five countries, Tunisia, Egypt, Yemen, Libya and Syria, became engulfed in a change infamously known as the Arab Spring. But what do we mean by the Arab Spring? Ghalib Khan takes a closer look.
The Arab Spring is a dramatic change in the political scene of the Middle East, with a revolutionary wave of demonstrations and protests, riots and civil wars that began on the 18th of December 2010. By March 2014, rulers had been forced out from power in Tunisia, Egypt twice, Libya and Yemen, with civil uprisings erupting in Bahrain and Syria.
There's no one single factor that explains why the Arab uprisings erupted in 2010-2011. But I think it's a process of accumulation and which climaxed in 2011 as a result, I would argue, of two major factors. Increase in food prices, which really basically aggravated the life and well-being of a huge constituency segment of the population, and also more and more people realized that the political system was bankrupt, that political authoritarianism pauperized and bankrupted the country.
Three years have passed since countries within the Middle East, predominantly the Arab states, erupted into mass protests and violence against their own governments, with the masses trying to make their voices heard. They asked for employment and education opportunities. They asked for the chance to form their own parties and an end to corruption. Some of these demonstrations were a success, and others continue to this day. Some failed entirely.
The causes of the Arab Spring can be grouped into the following three factors: authoritarian rule, an educated growing population, and economic problems. All of the countries involved in the Arab Spring were or are being governed by a dictator. Similarly, in all these countries, the dictator has taken to the seat of power through one of three means: by lineage, prior civil service, or through military coup. In all these countries, authoritarian rule for many decades did not allow for political participation and repressed many civil society and political movements. In most Middle Eastern polities, political opposition in the sense of organized and legitimate dissent, as is practiced in a democratic system, does not exist or is very weak. Political Islamic groups have filled this void. However, these parties may have their own agendas, as in the case of the Muslim Brotherhood, which was removed from power in the year 2013.
We've borne witness to the beginning of a new chapter in the history of a great country. And going forward, the United States will continue to stand up for democracy and the universal rights that all human beings deserve in Egypt and around the world.
The United States basically put most of its card with existing dictators and strongmen in the Middle East and other parts of the world. American foreign policy was driven by realism, not liberalism and idealism. In fact, democracy and human rights were sacrificed at the altar of America's material and economic interest in many parts of the world, including my own part of the world, the Arab world and the Middle East. So no, the quest for democracy, the promotion of democracy has never been a major driver in American foreign policy.
I have one thing to say to Obama. This is the Egyptian democracy, not his hypocrisy. He needs to look and see the million who made Mubarak fall. Not him, not Israel, not anybody else, but us, the Egyptian people.
The Middle East has one of the largest proportions of youth, or 12 to 24-year-olds, and the largest mass of unemployed youth in the world.
This swelling youth population in many cases is more educated. For instance, in Tunisia, a third of every Tunisian was able to attend higher education, and many of these were able to study in European countries. In Tunisia itself, there were 30% more education opportunities than employment opportunities. Furthermore, this increasingly young population was at the same time becoming more and more savvy about the world thanks to the internet. And that's one reason why Facebook and Twitter assumed such enormous relevance in the context of these protests and riots in different countries. In the case of Tunisia, the use of popular media in 2010 was extremely high. The amount of Tunisian Facebook users was considered amongst the highest in the world.
Another controversy which could have fueled the flames of dissent may have been through the exposure of corruption via the website WikiLeaks.
WikiLeaks is a controversial website which exposes 400,000 conversations between US ambassadors abroad and the US government. The information was provided by an ex-Australian soldier who was passionate about exposing the flaws he felt existed in US foreign policy. The cables, accessible to readers, exposed the corruption amongst the governments the US ambassadors liaised with. For many living under such regimes, this information was enlightening, infuriating, and embarrassing. The leaks inspired a website in Tunisia known as TuniLeaks, which portrayed the cables about the Tunisian government. Libya's government fared no differently in the exposure, since the cables brought to light the lavish lifestyles within the president's family. Corruption amongst government officials was also exposed before the public, and showed the juggling act the government was concerned with to prevent such hypocrisy becoming known. The situation of Tunisia was mirrored in Egypt, as Hosni Mubarak's government was shown to be struggling in economic reforms 4 years prior to the leaks. It exposed how political reform was also going around in circles.
In addition to the problems of poor governance, these countries also had their own socio-economic problems, with rising food prices, mass unemployment, and perks being given to those loyal to the government.
For decades, authoritarian regimes had bought off their own populations by providing jobs, especially in the bureaucracies and in the military. But the states no longer had enough money to do that, as economic growth, if any, could not keep pace with population growth.
Government bureaucracies are among the most important employers in most of the countries in the Middle East. But incompetence and red tape within these sectors and the lack of investment into the private sector has led to a stagnant job market. In some cases, there's also been a lack of diversification away from natural resources. Let's have a look at each country in turn. Libya did see a huge rise in foreign investment in the country, going from $451 million in 2000 to $19.3 billion in 2010. However, as the WikiLeaks cable showed beforehand, it was mostly government officials who benefited from such investment. The Gallup poll survey, which interviewed Tunisians in the years before the uprising, found that even though the economy was improving in 2010, the average Tunisian was hard put to benefit from it. A school teacher quit after suggesting teachers were badly paid, and employment overall was not promising. In Yemen, a third of the population suffered from chronic hunger,
and in 2008, demands for electoral reforms were met with police crackdown. Half of Yemeni people live off just $2 a day.
The people of Egypt, particularly the young people of Egypt, I want to be clear. We hear your voices. I have an unyielding belief that you will determine your own destiny and seize the promise of a better future for your children and your grandchildren. And I say that as someone who is committed to a partnership between the United States and Egypt.
Before the riots in Egypt, 10% of the population was unemployed, with youth unemployment standing at a staggering 25%. In 2010, emergency laws had to be enforced, and food price increases led to protests. In Syria, unemployment grew every year since the 1980s. Agriculture suffered due to lack of funding and a difficult climate, and only 25% of Syria's economy was based on the industry. Taxes did contribute to the country's wealth, but few people benefited from them. Corrupt regimes, poor living conditions, and extremist factions causing conflict in the country, it all seems the board was set for unrest.
So we can see that it took a combination of years of suppression, mass unemployment, an educated, internet-savvy population and rising fuel prices that led to these changes.
The term the Arab Spring was coined by the Western media. It was not a spring. We call it large-scale popular uprisings. Large-scale popular uprisings driven and informed by economic vulnerabilities and political authoritarianism. This process will unfold for many years. There's a great deal of dust. It will take many years for Arab societies to find basically solutions to their multiple problems. Yet, commentators in the West now, initially they celebrated the Arab Spring. They're saying the Arab world was joining the Western democratic process. Now Arab commentators have given up on the Arab world. The end of the Arab Spring. The Arab Spring is turning into a darkening winter because the tensions and the turmoil.
What is the future of Libya?
Democracy. Peace. And reconciliation.
However, it's in Syria where we see the greatest chaos. Now Syria is involved in civil war.
Let me be first very blunt. What happened in Syria in 2011 is very much the same what happened in Tunisia and Egypt and Yemen and Libya. This was a popular uprising against a dictatorship. It was a relatively peaceful form of uprising. And this particular popular peaceful uprising turned violent as a result of the regime's use of massive force against protesters. So it was the Assad regime that basically led and forced and caused the militarization of the conflict.
The troubles in Syria began in March 2011. The first major protest began as the Syrians hold the Day of Dignity protest in Damascus, demanding releases of political prisoners. Security forces shoot a number of people dead, leading to unrest and clashes. As the situation goes from bad to worse, a UN General Assembly resolution demands that President Assad resign. High-level defections gather pace, most notably Prime Minister Riyad Hijab, and US President Obama warns that use of chemical weapons would tilt the US towards intervention. The US and Britain demand an investigation into reports that government forces used chemical weapons. UN weapons inspectors conclude that chemical weapons were used in an attack but do not explicitly allocate responsibility for the attack. President Assad allows international inspectors to begin destroying Syria's chemical weapons on the basis of a US and Russian agreement. December 2013. US and Britain suspend non-lethal support for rebels in northern Syria after reports that Islamist rebels seize some bases of Western-backed Free Syrian Army.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.
All the violence must end. All the guns must fall silent.
Let me be clear. The internal Syrian variable, the internal Syrian element is the least important now. Neither the Syrian opposition nor the Assad regime really matters a great deal, because it's no longer just internal. This is a war by proxy. It's a geostrategic struggle by Iran and Saudi Arabia. Iran and Saudi Arabia are waging battle on Syrian streets. It's geostrategic, fierce geostrategic struggle, and also it's a global struggle by the United States and its allies and Russia. So in a way, it is already Syria a theater, a battlefield for others' wars, both the regional powers and the global powers.
So what's been the humanitarian cost of this all? Earlier on, we spoke to the spokesperson of Save the Children.
The situation in Syria is a stain on our humanity, on our conscience. The fact that this is allowed to happen in this day and age, where we see families being held, you know, hostage, villages under siege, kind of thing that you'd see in the medieval time. You know, you see people not being able to access food, water, medicine, shelter, the basics. The fact this has been allowed to go on for 3 years is an absolute outrage. Access into Syria has been the biggest challenge, not only for Save the Children, but for every other aid agency. Save the Children can work across the differently held parts of Syria, but it's a real, real challenge to get aid in. And as a consequence, we're working through partners and we're doing what we can. And I think we've reached over 1 million people now across the region. But that's a drop in the ocean when you consider what the needs really are. And access is really the biggest issue.
We are now left with several countries with a power vacuum, and Syria in particular is in the midst of civil war. But what has been done to help these countries transform peacefully? And in the case of Syria, what is being done to help stabilize the situation?
The Arab Spring has obviously been of great relevance to many governments around the world, given the strategic, political and economic interests everyone has in the Middle Eastern region. The UN has been an important arena, but responses have been different in each case, giving vastly diverging interests among great powers. On Yemen, for example, the UN has played a leading role, together with the Gulf Cooperation Council, the GCC. In Libya, driven by France as well as the UK and Turkey, the UN authorized airstrikes against the forces of Colonel Gaddafi when those were threatening to attack Benghazi. What initially seemed to represent an international consensus, however, then eroded quickly as Russia and China charged that Western countries had exceeded the mandate provided in a Security Council resolution authorizing, quote, all necessary measures. Not least because of this divergence of views over Syria, the great powers have been sharply divided. Russia and China have vetoed a series of proposed Security Council resolutions, impeding an international response authorized by the UN. As a result, there has been little progress, despite the efforts of an envoy dispatched jointly by the UN and the Arab League, and several rounds of talks in Geneva.
In this regard, earlier on, I had the opportunity to speak to Farhan Haq, the associate spokesperson for the General Secretary of the United Nations, Ban Ki-moon.
Well, the Security Council works best when its members work in a unified manner. And in recent days, you've seen that the Security Council is trying to discuss, as a collective, the humanitarian situation in Syria. And they have been considering efforts to deal with the issue of access. The Russian Federation has come up with its proposals. The other countries have come up with their own proposals. And we're hoping that they can unite and realize that the people in Syria need this aid right now, and we need to be able to find a way to get it to them.
On the ground, there have been instances of intervention, primarily clandestine and in terms of the supply of arms. Saudi Arabia, Qatar and others have been actively channeling weapons to the Syrian rebels, while Iran, Russia and the Lebanese Hezbollah have been more or less open to their support for the Assad regime.
All the violence must end. All the guns must fall silent.
Western powers have found it difficult to define their response, on the one hand wanting to support the rebels, but not wanting military intervention in the region.
The United States is disgusted that a couple members of this council continue to prevent us from fulfilling our sole purpose here, addressing an ever-deepening crisis in Syria and a growing threat to regional peace and security.
It's been hard to get them to the table, and of course it's hard to achieve a lot while the parties are at the table, but at least for the first time they have come to the negotiating table, they have been prepared to talk to each other, and we've had one concrete measure that has come out of it, which is to say the humanitarian access that we've been able to get to the old city of Homs. Millions of people have either been internally displaced inside Syria or have been made into refugees. There are over 2 million refugees in other countries, but inside the country, there's several million people who are in areas that are intermittently cut off by fighting. We've been trying, as you know, to get access to all of the hard-to-reach areas of Syria, and we're hoping that the recent days' worth of work that we've been able to do in Homs is a precedent for the sort of access we can get to other areas that have been cut off by fighting.
The result has been a lack of response, and more than 100,000 people have now died in Syria.
There is no doubt whatsoever that the Syrian authorities bear a huge share of responsibility for the situation. But one shouldn't ignore the fact that for a long time now they have been fighting not unarmed men, but combat units such as the Syrian Free Army and extremist groups including Al-Qaeda.
The international community should say with one voice, without hesitation or caveat, that the killings of innocent Syrians must stop and a political transition must begin.
We have heard too many broken promises, even within the past 24 hours. Such violence is unacceptable before humanity. How many deaths will it take to halt this dangerous slide toward civil war and sectarian strife?
The region is on its own, and the region faces major challenges, and the people in the region must stand up and address their own problems. It's their future. That's online. And I think if they are basically thinking, if some people think that the United States and Europe would come to their aid and resolve their organic or chronic difficulties, I think this would be a great miscalculation on the part of some of the elite forces in the region who think that somehow Europe or the United States would be able to help them basically resolve or even overcome some of their major difficulties and challenges.
The Middle East, with Syria at its epicenter, is already in chaos and at crisis point. The effects of this catastrophe could be felt regionally or even internationally. But what is the way out, and what can be done to help the region?
The supreme leader of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community has commented on the situation.
So what should be done in Syria? If the world sees that cruelty and oppression is continuing to take place and the desperate Syrian people are crying out for help, then the neighboring countries should unite together in order to stop the cruelty and establish peace. They should not seek to fulfill personal or vested interests, but their goal should only be the peace and prosperity of the local people. The Holy Quran teaches that when cruelty has been successfully stopped and the aggressor pledges and adopts peace, then undue restrictions should not be enforced as a means to express power and might. Although this key principle particularly applies where one country attacks another, it can actually be applied to all situations in order to establish peace.
The Middle East is now at crisis point. People came to the streets demanding a change for a better life, but poor governance and people not respecting the law of the land has led to even more hardship. And now Syria is engulfed in civil war, and no one knows which way things will turn. But there is good hope for change. If governments work together for the interest of the country at stake, and people work together for the common good of all, the fruits of the Arab Spring may be harvested by all.